Developing countries bear 93% of the worldwide burden of disease. Over 95% of medical equipment used in developing countries are imported. There's virtually no local production of medical equipment in these settings. The World Health Organization estimates that 7 out of 10 devices designed for use in a developed setting don't work upon arrival in a developing world setting. This is primarily due to the fact that there are a lack of spare parts, a lack of consumables, such as fluids or supplies that are used to maintain the equipment, and also there are a lack of trained technical staff. The design of health-related technologies for resource-limited settings requires the detailed consideration of the end users and target communities, well beyond the traditional needs assessment that we do in an engineering typical design process. In a broader sense, the cultural, social, and economic constraints associated with design need to be incorporated in order to develop sustainable products that will have a social impact. As a graduate student studying medical engineering, I had the opportunity to spend several months in India conducting clinical elective training. On one of my rotations, I went out with a set of community healthcare workers. We went door to door in urban and rural resettlement colonies, collecting medical census data of family members. The workers were equipped with only a clipboard, paper, pencil. They brought that information and data back to a building located nearby the one shown here. On one of the outings, I was curious to see what happened to the data after it was collected, and I followed them into the room. The only thing in the room was a long table, 3 chairs. There was one worker there, but typically there are 3. In a corner was a stack of ledger books. The men's job was to transcribe the information brought back by the healthcare workers into each of the 3 books. One stayed locally, one went to the district hospital, one went to the state. I was surprised when I saw in the corner on a windowsill a dusty pile of Palm Pilots. They seemed completely out of place. Being a tech geek, I ran over and wanted to see what they were. I picked them up, looked them over. There were property ID tags from a well-known US institution on these devices. I was playing with them, they weren't turning on. I checked to see if there were batteries, no batteries in there. When I asked initially what the purpose of the devices were, the response was, they don't work, and I didn't get much else. But I kept talking to the men about their jobs. And later on, they told me that these were delivered as part of a student design project, and they were meant to help facilitate the data collection of the community healthcare workers. But the men took the batteries out on the first day and said they didn't work because they were concerned that the device would replace their jobs. One job, 2 jobs, potentially all 3, because they were no longer needed to transcribe the information. It's no doubt that the student team that designed these spent countless hours designing a robust electronic medical record system. But they never visited the community. They never spoke with the community healthcare workers, let alone talk to the people downstream who might be affected. And it was at that point in time that I realized how important it is to truly understand the needs of the end users. Upon arriving at Michigan, I wanted to dedicate some of my time to developing a program with my colleague Eileen Huang Saad that would give our undergraduate students the chance to engage in design projects that involve the community members. So designing with the community versus for the community. We've put together a program centered on an immersive experience. We've been working in Ghana with our clinical colleagues there. We send our students for weeks to months. They do clinical observations to identify needs, unmet needs in the hospital setting. We've been focusing on maternal health. They talk to nurses, doctors, midwives, patients. They then bring those problems and challenges back to U of M. They spend their senior design course working on addressing those needs, and they return to the field site with their prototypes, test them, get critiques, redesign, trying with each iteration to get closer to what's actually needed by the end users. We try to teach them to engage the community members and stakeholders throughout the entire design process. Immersion and having the input of the end users at the problem definition phase is essential. However, you need to have that interaction throughout the concept generation, selection, prototype development, and validation phases. We also encourage them to consider the development of sustainable relationships. This is something that's oftentimes overlooked. Even though student groups have good intentions, they drop into a community and do something what I term the hit and run. They go in for a week, a couple weeks, try to help out, but then need to retreat and move on to something else. So we ask our students to think about development of sustainable relationships where the partners have mutually beneficial outcomes. I want to share with you now a few examples of the projects our students have been working on. We aim to develop low-cost, elegant, and intuitive, easy-to-use solutions to problems. This is a problem centered on equipment for labor and delivery, maternal health. You can see here, this is taken from a picture, a hospital in Ghana, a supine labor bed. At this setting, women labor in one of nine of these beds until they're 9 centimeters dilated. They stand up, walk themselves over to one of two delivery chairs. So we have 9 feeding into 2. This works, surprisingly enough, in the majority of the time. However, when you have peaks of high patient load, we can see all sorts of things happening. Women delivering mid-stride as they try to transfer themselves in a hurry from the supine bed to the delivery chair. Doctors, nurses, midwives having to deliver women on the bed that's not designed for delivery. And even further backlog of women delivering in the hallways. So two of our student teams have worked on designing a reconfigurable labor and delivery bed. Some of our other student groups that have tried to address this general problem of increasing capacity for healthcare workers to accommodate women in labor and delivery have done it in a more rural setting. Here's a project that looks like a foldable lawn chair, and that's, I guess, the inspiration. But this is a portable pelvic examination table that a community healthcare worker could fold up into a backpack and carry by motorbike into a community. And instead of performing the pelvic exam on the floor, you can provide an exam on a raised surface, increasing the efficacy of the exam and providing a woman with more dignity. Student member Joey Porosky traveled to Ghana on numerous occasions and spent months talking to people about this particular problem and getting critiques on the design. He carried it by motorbike to communities and engaged with pregnant women to try to figure out how they would see the design changed to improve the ability of the healthcare worker to perform the exam and to increase their comfort. A current student group is addressing a slightly different problem. This is conceptual at this stage, but what they're interested in doing is being able to develop a simple device that can be placed on one of the supine beds, allowing women to labor if they can't move over to one of the two delivery chairs. Another problem we've been addressing, autologous blood transfusion. If a woman has a ruptured ectopic pregnancy, she needs to have blood retransfused. Here, in certain settings throughout West Africa, they use a soup ladle transfusion method where they use literally a soup ladle, scoop the blood out of the abdominal cavity, filter it through gauze and the funnel that's seen here. It drops into a bottle that's put into a blood bag and retransfused into the woman. So we were asked if we could improve the process. We were asked to develop an electromechanical system to improve the process. But the students had conducted observations in the biomedical engineering unit and noticed that the majority of the electromechanical equipment was difficult to maintain because of the spare part and technical training issues. Therefore, they came up with a purely mechanical system. It looks like a giant syringe, and that's effectively what it is. It has a series of inline filters and one-way valves so that you can suction blood out and filter it, and then on the downstroke, you can send the blood out of a tube to a blood bag. This was a very well-received idea on our most recent trip in early March to Ghana, and the students are incorporating design changes as we speak. The last problem that I want to share with you is male circumcision. So 72% of the HIV/AIDS-related deaths occur in sub-Saharan Africa. It's been shown that male circumcision can reduce the risk of HIV transmission by 48 to 60%. Circumcision can occur in a clinical setting or in a traditional environment. In a traditional setting, it's a ritual, a rite of passage from boyhood to manhood. Here you see a young Kenyan boy undergoing a ritual circumcision. The foreskin's pulled over the glands of the penis, and in some cases, a guillotine-style cut is made. So the cutter can be blind to the end of the penis, resulting in lacerations, amputations, hemorrhage, sepsis, and even death. A group of mechanical engineering students worked on designing a culturally acceptable intervention to improve the safe outcomes for individuals interested in continuing to practice traditional circumcision, despite the push by ministries of health to have this done in a clinical setting. They created this, which when we took it to Uganda and met with hundreds of clan leaders, cutters, assistant cutters, they named it the Defender. They put it on their finger. They knew immediately how it would be used. It's a cage to protect the glands. But they gave us critical insight that we were not able to figure out from the literature that we had available to us in Ann Arbor. They told us the cut has to be made quickly. How quickly, we ask. Within the time it takes to throw coconut up in the air and hit the ground. They told us that they didn't believe that our design, which was geared towards one size fit most, would work. They said, we're used to buying t-shirts in small, medium, and large sizes. Don't make us a one size fits all. We want a one size fits most. So we're in the process of trying to integrate that feedback into a new design. In closing, design with the community is not a novel concept. It draws from best practices in anthropology, social work, business, just to name a few fields. But it's a co-creative process is easier said than done. It's very simple to talk the talk and say that you're going to involve end users throughout the entire process. It's something different to actually go out and do it. So I challenge you, as you engage in design projects, be it in Ann Arbor, Detroit, Ghana, Uganda, or elsewhere, immerse yourself in the environment. Seek to understand the true needs of the end users. Involve them throughout the entire design process. Develop sustainable, mutually beneficial relationships and design with the community. Thank you.